This is the Rock and Roll Autopsy Podcast.
All right, I'm going to zap her again. Charge up the paddles. Come on, let's go, let's go.
Sorry, Doctor.
Hold the compressions.
Clear.
Straight line.
Welcome to Rock and Roll Autopsy. It's the Forensic Files on your radio dial. My name is Scott.
And this is Rico.
Man, have we got a show for you tonight. We are going to not start the show, but instead...
Not yet.
Answer the phone.
Hey, request line, man. Let's see who it is.
All right. WRNRA, you're east of the Rockies.
Oh, it's the breather.
He's back.
The All breather. Right. Like this guy.
All right, breather. What's going on tonight?
How are you doing? All right.
All right. You have a request tonight? A song you'd like to hear us perform an autopsy on?
Come on. Wait. Hold on. What was that?
I thought you spoke breather.
I said.
Oh, right.
I got it. Okay. He's got a request. He wants us to do Home Sweet Home by Motley Crue.
All right. Hey, see you later, buddy.
Well, listen, I cannot wait to dive into this autopsy. We are psyched. We are here.
I can't wait for this one.
It's Motley Crue, Home Sweet Home. But first,
the news.
What is this garbage you're watching? I want to watch the news. This is the news.
All right, May 29th, 1999. Photographers taking shots of old cars wrecked at the bottom of Malibu's Decker Canyon discover the body of Iron Butterfly bassist Philip Kramer, who had gone missing on February 12th, 1995. His death is ruled a suicide.
Okay, so I think, honestly, we could spend probably at least a half an hour talking about this news story, but in the interest of our highly scientific autopsy, let's just do some broad strokes. This is fucking fascinating. I didn't know this. This guy, Philip Kramer, bassist for Iron Butterfly, right? In the God of DeVita, right? Not really the name of the song, but the guy was so fucked up that instead of In the Garden of Eden, it wound up in the God of DeVita, okay?
Yeah.
This is that band, and this guy went on to become an aerospace engineer. He pioneered, like, audio compression technology for CDs, and had this one thing, I don't want to get into it, but he had this other technology that was supposed to be faster than light technology or some kind of weird bullshit that he developed. And the story is, this was after he was, yeah, I know this, it's, you gotta,
and he somehow ends up in the bottom of a canyon dead.
That's it, seriously. So he was supposed to go to the airport to pick up a colleague and his wife, and they were going to go out to eat, and Philip Kramer's wife was going to meet them at the restaurant, I think is how it went. So he picks them up from the airport, but then he calls his wife on the phone and says, I'm going to drop them off at the hotel and then you meet us. So he drops them off at the hotel and then fucking disappears and nobody can find him. So yeah, so then there's this one canyon, what does it say,
Decker's
Canyon, where there's cars in the canyon, and they find his skeleton in the canyon in one of the cars.
No way.
The problem is, some people don't think that this was a suicide because of some weird ass technology that he had developed, and he had made, apparently there was some kind of code that he had with his father to where if he called and said something about killing himself, that was actually code for the complete opposite, that I'm in trouble and I need help.
Wow.
So there's some people that think that he was murdered because of some fucking technology that he had developed. That this story is weird and super duper fascinating.
I have never heard of this in my life.
Me either.
I only know that, like, there's people who put on Iron Butterfly in Agata DeVita, and, like, by the time the song is over,
they're ready to drive into a canyon themselves, right?
Yeah. They're just skeletons sitting under couch while the needle skips on the record as it ended. You know, it's because it's like a 25-minute song.
It's great. I love every minute of it. But, this story, like, in everybody's spare time, when you have a few minutes on a Saturday afternoon, look up Phil Kramer's death.
Wow.
It's fascinating.
I'm going to have to see if there's like a documentary or something on this.
I hope there is.
Myself up on it a little
I hope
bit.
There is. And I'm sure I didn't accurately represent all of the, but I gave you enough to just look it up, dude. It's fascinating.
And if you don't want to look that up, go listen to Slayer's cover of Inagata DeVita from the Less Than Zero soundtrack. It's fantabulous.
Amazeballs. Oh. Shit.
Oh, technical difficulties. Fumble.
Dropped my phone. Sorry.
And crashed into the TV stand.
So I put this one in here just for you. So May 31st, 1985, the Parents Music Resource Center, otherwise known as the PMRC, sends its very first letter to the RIAA requesting a ratings system for albums and concerts. The group is led by our favorite second lady, Tipper Gore. The wife of Senator Al Gore, future Mrs. Vice President. So the record industry takes it seriously and cuts back on their metal budgets. The end result is warning stickers. How about that? Wah, 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 wah.
I mean, and if you saw that warning sticker on a record, it wasn't a deterrent. It was this is the record I need. It's got the warning sticker.
Exactly. It was parental, a big giant light saying, buy this album.
Yeah, what did it say? Parental advisory, explicit content.
Explicit lyrics, I think is what it started. I don't know. I can't remember.
So this gave like the especially the metal community something to rally around, right? Because famously you had the you know, there's no reason to go over this. Anybody can, like, you can literally watch the congressional testimony on YouTube of like John Denver and Frank Zappa and Dee Snider. But some great songs came out of it, and it gave all the metal bands
we're
had a
not
song.
Gonna take it.
Yeah, and all the metal bands wrote a song about how they hated the PMRC. A famous one is Hook in Mouth by Megadeth, where the chorus goes, what is it? F is for fighting. R is for red, ancestors' blood in the battles they shed. E, we elect them. E, we eject them in the land of the free and the home of the brave. D is for dying. O, your overture. M is for money, and you know what that cures. This spells out freedom. It means nothing to me as long as there's a PMRC. And so every band did like a PMRC song back then. And every band did. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, people. Glad you enjoyed the show. Thank you. And every band did a PMRC song, and every band did a hypocritical religious leader song. There was Miracle Man by Ozzy Osbourne against Jimmy Swaggart. There was Holy Smoke by Iron Maiden, also against like Pat Robertson, Jimmy Swaggart, and Jim Baker. So remember, all those guys in the 80s were, you know, on this pedestal and had these falls from grace.
For sure.
You know, so... So, yeah, it was just great fodder for, you know, what a great era of music, man. Because it was like, you know, heavy metal was like outlaw music. And you had, it was actually stirring stuff up. And then, you know, and that continued with like Ice-T and Cop Killer. It was fun. Nobody does anything that makes anybody mad anymore, you know?
Let me ask you, it's all very safe. Let me ask you something. And maybe I'm way off base here. But do you think there's a connection between Tipper Gore and the PMRC and the Telecommunications Act? Because the Telecommunications Act...
1996, so now one company could own every single radio station in the area, basically.
Which killed a lot of music.
Yeah, I'm not smart enough to know.
Do you think there's a connection? Because maybe that's an underhanded coup de grace. If I can't get them this way, then I'll just put together the Telecommunications Act, which will turn rock and roll and everything that we don't like about it corporate, and they will put the hammer down on everybody from a corporate perspective. So that was another way to handcuff rock, was to make it corporate by passing the Telecommunications Act. Do you think there's a connection there, or am I way off base?
It's interesting. I have no idea. I mean, I just think of the Tipper Gore thing. It was there was a moral panic in the 80s. You know, there was the satanic panic and these other, it was the rise of the Christian moralists. And so you had the Washington Wives kind of riding the coattails of everybody was worried. There's this big panic around heavy metal music. Remember Geraldo famously did his special, right? So it was just all a byproduct of an
80s. Was this before or after that lame ass Al Capone digging the vault out and there was nothing there? They made such a big, remember that shit?
Yeah, I do. I remember I watched both of them live. Oh, but I remember watching the,
it was
the
fascinating,
the Satanic Panic one. I remember watching that one live. I loved it, man. I got to see King Diamond on primetime TV. King, it was great. You know what I mean? Jesus, I fucking Christ. Loved it.
King Diamond.
All right. June 1st, 1999, Napster, a file sharing service that lets users download songs for free, goes online. It shuts down in 2001 amid a raft of lawsuits.
Thank you, Metallica.
But not before upending the music industry, which sees a steep decline in sales of CDs.
It's where it all started. And that charge was led by Metallica, I believe, wasn't it?
Yeah, I remember there was a Spin magazine cover with Lars Ulrich and Prince and somebody else, and they were marching, playing the drums, you know, that famous kind of Revolutionary War image. I can't remember who
the little tilty drum where you're holding this, not match grip, and you're going dead. Yeah, I got you.
But there were a few musicians, on that tip. I mean, I don't know, man. I don't know what to say about this. It hasn't already been said a million times. Yeah. I mean, it's the music industry has changed and gone through shifts and technology. And it's changed many times, and it was another, significant, change.
I think people are buying more. I don't know this for a fact, but let me ask you, do you think? I think yes. Do you think people are buying more vinyl nowadays than CDs? Well, I think for sure.
Now,
right?
Yeah, I don't. Yeah, think for sure. Right? I think CD sales are in the toilet, and vinyl's made a comeback. There's a lot of audiophiles who
you like vinyl.
I don't. I mean, I own a couple records that are on that shelf down there, but I don't have a record player, and so I haven't listened to vinyl since I was a kid, and it was actually a method of listening to records.
The only method.
Not nostalgic.
I like vinyl, dude. I like the warm analog vibe you get from it.
Yeah.
It's cool. I like it.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. Here's the thing, is that this whole Napster thing, it's hard for me to have, this is going to sound really weird, but it's, to me, it's generational, and it's hard for me to have a hardcore opinion on it, because at that time, by 1996, I'm a full-on adult, approaching 30 by that time. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it's I'm kind of already aging out of the buying CDs. Even if CDs maintained popularity and there was no such thing as Napster, you buy fewer as you get older. You do all your collecting when you're 14 and you're a teenager and you're flipping burgers and you have disposable income. By that point, I was aging out of a lot of it. Music had changed. I was finding my tastes were already falling out of favor. And so I was already when this shit was happening, I mean, I didn't really think anything of it other than that I went online and was like, oh, here's songs I already own and now I can just download them for free. And it was I already had 1,000 CDs. You know what I mean? It wasn't and I was buying less at that point just naturally because I was getting older. Yeah. You know?
See, for me, it was the opposite. I never had enough disposable because I never worked. I went from high school to college and I played baseball. And so I never had enough spare money to just develop a CD collection. And so when this stuff came out, the IRC channels and Napster and all that stuff, I was full on, because now I could download all the shit that I wanted to buy in the past but couldn't afford it. So I was really happy that this stuff was coming out. So I was kind of like the opposite of you, even though I'm a little bit older than you are. I was full on because I didn't have the I didn't have the giant CD collection already. I had maybe a handful, and that was it. So this was a way for me to get all the music that I always ever wanted but couldn't afford.
Yeah, I mean, I always had a gig, you know what I mean? So it was like by the time I was, you know, whatever old, 11, 12 years old, I was delivering papers, and I was flipping burgers, and I was bagging groceries, yeah. And it was like, I was always working, you know, all throughout school.
Cleaning floors at the mall or whatever else
you're doing. Yeah, so it was always generating income, and then eventually that income would be used to live on, so then my purchase of, you know, frivolous things would diminish, right? But, you know, when you're a teenager, you buy a pair of shoes and buy a CD and be happy, and it was like, you know, it was just so it didn't. It, I think my thought was when I saw that, like, for one thing, as someone who was buying music, when I saw people no longer had to buy it, I thought, well, that's stealing, was my initial thought, because I was someone who was buying music. I earned and paid for all of it. So I was like, well, this is stealing and that's probably wrong. And I thought, this is probably going to be bad for artists, you know. My opinion on it has evolved over the years. I don't know if you can stop, you know, technology or progress. And I think the record company was, you know, obviously slow to adapt. You know, and now people, again, it's like come full circle to where you had this window of time where people just were not paying for music. And now people are paying for music again. People subscribe to streaming services, and that's pretty much the way. Nobody goes on LimeWire or BitTorrent sites anymore to download music, because it almost feels ridiculous because everything's on Spotify or YouTube Music or Apple or whatever you use, and you just pay your $10 a month and basically have access to whatever you want.
Yep.
So I think it's kind of come full circle to where now people are willingly paying for music. I mean, Steve Jobs tried with, you know, iTunes to get people to pay 99 cents a song. That didn't really work because songs were still available for free. But it's eventually it kind of came full circle. Is it as lucrative for bands as selling records? I don't think so. You hear a lot of quibbling about how little they make from Spotify. And I do think there's like some side ramifications. Like there's a recent article in Rolling Stone where they interview Matt Cameron and Chad Smith, I think, about the death of Taylor Hawkins. And they say Taylor Hawkins was just burnt out of being on the road and had expressed to Dave Grohl that he just did not want to tour anymore. And when these bands are forced to tour nonstop because it's literally their only source of revenue because there are no more album sales, I think it does have ramifications because dudes want to come off the road. And especially for younger bands who haven't quite made it, if you look at their wiki pages and you see a younger band, they'll have like, you know, they'll have like four members, and you look at past members and it'll be like 30 people because they can't keep the same lineups because people are burning the fuck out.
You know, that's a great point.
On the road.
You used to go on tour to promote the album, which will increase album sales, which will allow you to catch a break and write some new stuff and get your druthers and
get off the road
and kind of recharge your battery a little bit. But now there's no album to promote, so you have to tour to make money. And then when you're done touring, then you got to pump out some new material without having any time to recharge your battery. And then you got to go back on tour so that you can fund the next recording session so you never catch a break. So that's a really great point.
Well, so you can just keep the business going.
That's right. Like, so you can't just catch a break and just let your album sales pay your bills for a minute.
Yeah,
because Dave, there isn't that anymore.
Dave Mustaine has a quote about that where he said albums are now just business cards. You know, that's effectively all they are.
Yep.
You know, and you're not touring to support record sales because they're not there. You're touring because that's your source of income now. That's how you make a living as a band. But if the guys can't come off the road, that's problematic too, because, you know, there's a mental health component at work there.
I mean, maybe, you know, nowadays, how does everything get paid for nowadays? Advertising, Spotify, YouTube, everything is all about monetizing through advertisement, but it's hard to do that when you go on tour. You can't sell advertisement on a tour, you know what I mean? When you're playing live, if there was a way to do that, then maybe those guys could catch a break. Maybe what? You stop touring and just put all your live shows on YouTube and then monetize that through advertising, for example, and then you'd have a chance to catch a break. I mean, maybe that's it. Maybe you got to just go the advertising route and just post shit on YouTube or whatever and just rely on advertising dollars. That could be your album.
Yeah, you have to be attractive to advertisers though and have the equity.
Well, they just care about clicks, you know what I mean?
To be able to pull enough clicks in though, you know what I'm saying, to make
it. So instead of doing a live show, what about that? Instead of touring a live show to rely on revenue to pay your bills, you just host a concert on YouTube and just rely on your clicks to get advertising dollars, and that pays your bills. So that's kind of like the modern day version of an album. You just post a live show on YouTube and let the clicks pay for your bills, right?
Yeah, again though, but I don't know that YouTube is, I mean,
for lack of a better example,
you got to have, you know, people have to watch the whole damn advertisement. There's a whole thing to get paid on there. But and I think Kiss just did something similar like a year ago when they did like a New Year's show at Dubai, and it was basically like like pay-per-view.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Anyway, we have one more news item.
Here we go. Ready, sir? Yep, June 2nd, 1980. I did this just for you, man. June 2nd, 1983, the 12-inch remix of The Safety Dance by Men Without Hats goes number one on the Billboard dance charts. MTV begins playing the huzzah-worthy video, and the song soon rises up to the Hot 100.
The Safety Dance.
The Safety Dance, man. You have the picture on the wall. We're looking at it right now.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest with you. I don't have, and I'm not trying to burst your bubble.
No, I know.
The Safety Dance is fine, but it really is a song my wife.
I know. It's more your wife's thing.
So it is a part of my life because of her.
Right.
And we all appreciate a video where it's like medieval and the guy's like
doing the arm thing,
dancing with a dwarf in a field.
Right.
It's like, you know, it's like the Stonehenge portion of the Spinal Tap show all of a sudden.
It's so, like a cool poppy medieval times kind of a deal, right?
Yeah.
But no, I know it's more your wife's thing, but it's still a fun song. Come on, everybody that knows that song kind of digs it in a little bit of a way, right?
All right, we went a little long on the news because of fucking story time, but we come back. Motley Crue, Home Sweet Home. We'll be right back.
I've been wearing minimalist shoes now for a little while, and honestly, I've tried a few different kinds and have had some varying results, but the ones that I'm wearing right now are from Zero with an X. That's X-E-R-O. They're based out of Denver, Colorado, and these shoes are absolutely amazing. The style I'm wearing right now are the Prio, but they have other styles depending on what kind of activity level you're doing, whether it's some heavy hiking or some road work, or if you just need some sandals for the beach. These shoes are incredibly put together. The soles come with a 5,000 mile guarantee. The uppers come with a Huarache style strap. So if you need to snug the uppers up a little bit closer to your feet, it's very easy to do that without compromising the comfort. The toe box is nice and wide to allow your toes to spread out the way they're intended to, instead of getting squished together like typical shoes do, and it doesn't look awkward either. These shoes are not only well put together, but they look amazing as well. They're fantastic. They're honestly one of the most comfortable pairs of shoes I've ever owned. But please, do not take my word for it. Go to the website. It's zeroshoes.com. That's again with an X. That's xeroshoes.com/go/RNRA affiliate. That's our affiliate link. Do your own research. Again, don't take my word for it. Look and see what they have. If you like what you see, and if you got yourself a pair, you'd love them just as much as I do.
We are gathered here to remember rock and roll. Rock was born the rambunctious son of country, western, and blues. In the year of our Lord, 1955. On this day, the birth of rock and roll gifted under the world a gyrating pelvis, a throbbing beat, and a pulsating rhythm. A sound so infectious and rollicking that it would endow previously scrupulous young minds with identity, individualism, and purpose, thus setting forth a multi-generational pursuit of all that is loud, debaucherous, and unholy. But, sadly, like all earthly endeavors, rock too must perish. Oh, we mourn the loss of rock and roll, with its ridiculously old standard bearers still on tour and charging ungodly amounts of Mad Jack to witness their long past the sell-by date asses on stage, and with its chauvinism, misogyny, and whiteness no longer aligning with modern sensibilities, and with its aging, fist-shaking fan base kicking every would-be rocker off their proverbial lawn, rock has indeed passed into the celestial void. May rock rest in peace in eternal cacophonous slumber. Amen.
Thank you for that, Scott.
You are listening to the Rock and Roll Autopsy Podcast.
The Autopsy Report.
All right, Home Sweet Home off the Theater of Pain album, released 1985. It's a power ballad. Off the Theater of Pain album, and again in 1991 off the Decade of Decadence compilation album. It's been covered by several artists, most notably country singer Carrie Underwood, who released her version in 2009. Home Sweet Home, Scott. Welcome home.
All right, Rico, let's perform an autopsy on this mug.
Let's do it.
We've got a scientific scoring system. Do not try this at home. We are amateurs. We've got five categories. They are gratuitous boomerism.
Boomer.
Excessive misogyny.
Misogyny.
Wanton whiteness.
Whitey.
Malignant machismo.
Macho.
Culture vulturism.
Vultures.
Category one, Home Sweet Home, Motley Crue, it's Theater of Pain, it's gratuitous boomerism. Rico, how do you score?
How do you assign boomerism to this song? I mean, I'm not feeling boomerism in this song. It's a song about missing your home, dude. That's cross-generational, isn't it? I miss being home because I'm out doing mountains of blow, and I just want to be home doing it in my own house. That's multi-generational. There's nothing boomer-exclusive about that. I'm giving that one a zero.
I'm going to give it a zero as well. I'm just not seeing it. If it was there, I'd see it. I'd feel it. I don't see it. Category two, excessive misogyny.
No, again, there's no misogyny in this. It's just, I mean, there's misogyny around it. There's just no misogyny in it. It's a song about wanting to be home, man. They miss being in their homes.
Why would these guys, can we just be real for a minute? Yeah. I'm scoring it a zero, too.
It's a zero.
Can we just be real for a minute?
Let's, please.
Why would these guys ever come off the road?
That's a great question,
They
man.
Lived like Vikings.
Everything
They were raping and pillaging everything, doing mountains
They were
blow.
Raping and pillaging each other's girlfriends.
They're just banging everything in sight.
Everything they ever wanted was on the road.
Do you ever wake up one morning and be like, yeah, I don't know if I can bang 14 girls today. I think I need to go home.
Dude, it happens to me all the time.
I need to...
All the time. It gets old after a while.
I need to go back to mom and dad's place and sleep in my bedroom that I grew
up. I'm going to get up tomorrow and probably rail half a dozen girls before I, you know, get motivated for the day. No, I have no idea what that's like.
I mean, if you're a member of Motley Crue, I mean, there's no reason that you're above the law. I mean, you live an outlaw, lawless lifestyle.
They even said that we wrote this song because... all we ever wanted was to be on the road, and then when we got on the road, we just wanted to be home. That makes no fucking sense whatsoever. Like you said, living like Vikings, dude.
What a great analogy. They were just ripping through town by town,
just
man.
Town, just raping and pillaging, just city after city across the country and across. Why would you ever want it? That's, dude, that ain't a train I want to get off of. I'm just staying on. I'm going to ride it till
I'm going to ride that train till you can't ride it anymore.
Category 3, wanton whiteness. Rico, how do you score it?
Zero, dude, because lots of, again, there's nothing white about exclusive. There's nothing whitey about wanting to be home.
Yeah.
Sorry, man. I mean, it is what it is. It's just there's nothing whitey about missing your home. Right?
I'm gonna give it a 0.5, and I'll tell you why.
Ooh,
because
the
lyrics are so bad.
Do we want to do this?
Well, listen, these are white boy lyrics. These are lyrics written by
me. Hit me with a couple of good lines.
You know, I'm a dreamer. But my heart's of gold. I had to run away high so I wouldn't come home low. And just when things went right, it doesn't mean they were always wrong. Just take this song and you'll never feel left all alone.
I take it back. I might have to give that a 0.5 too.
I mean, those are some.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's do a 0.5.
Those are some
white
ass lyrics. That is
white bread lyrics right there.
Category 4, malignant machismo. Rico, how do you score?
Man, zero. I mean, they've got a nice melodic piano going there, thanks to Tommy Lee, who wrote that. Good on him. No, it's a zero, dude. Yeah. I'm sorry I feel that way. I mean, I want to give it a 1, but I've got no reason to.
This song is just so nondescript.
Song is the antithesis of anything that Motley Crue stands for.
It really is, and it's just almost not even there. It's like we're just scoring it a bunch. It's so vapid and empty that there's nothing to even rate or discuss.
Vapid.
Other than it is just overly sentimental. It's like a fucking, like, it's like a goddamn greeting card.
Dude.
Like, you're standing there at Target and it's somebody's, like, you know, somebody died and you're gonna like buy him a goddamn sympathy card. And
this,
you're just
song,
browsing through him and you're like, it's
this,
syrupy.
This is the most, is as bad as their catalog is, in my opinion. This is the most vanilla thing that they've ever written, dude. There's no flavor to this song whatsoever. I'm sorry it introduced the world to the power ballad. I get it, but it's the opposite of everything that Motley Crue stands for.
The worst part is that the power ballad became like every 80s hair band had to have one on
because
every
of
record,
this song.
Basically after this song.
That's right.
And I mean, and sadly, this fucking record is so bad that this is the best song on the record, and this song blows.
I mean, I have to say, smoking in the boys' room, I like that because it's kind of old schoolish, right?
It is. It's not their song. It's like the band's, like, what is it, Brownsville Station or something? It's a cover song.
Exactly.
And it's a good song.
It's a good song, and I like the way
the best two songs on the record are a cover and a really syrupy,
vanilla,
overly sentimental, vanilla, vapid
ballad, right. Yeah.
And so, the rest of the album is just horrid.
Typically, when we're getting ready for these episodes, like, I usually don't have a lot of trouble, like, spinning these albums 6 or 8 or 10 times, right? It took me 3 different sessions just to get through this thing once. This album, and even if you watch the movie, even Vince Neil himself tells Doc McGee that this album is shit. So there's no way that they even thought that this was a good album.
I like I've seen too many romantic dreams up in lights, fallen off the silver screen. What is
what
Vince,
the hell is th-
what is okay? Vince
Dude,
doesn't
that's
write the lyrics,
no Six wrote the lyrics. Yeah,
what is Nikki Six's vision of a romantic dream?
He has no idea.
What is romance to Nikki Six? Fisting some 14-year-old runaway? Oh, I mean, what the fuck? I mean, he's lamenting the loss of romance.
I don't.
Are you serial? This is Motley Crue.
What romance did he ever have?
Yeah, snorting rails of coke off the stomach of some naked prostitute.
What's romantic about that?
I mean, come on. All right.
Where did he get that from?
I don't know. Jesus Christ. I'm scoring Malignant Machismo a zero as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, that's a big fucking.
Category 5, culture vulturism. Rico, how do you score?
No, this is a zero. They invented the power ballad.
It's almost as if... Oh, my God.
This is a zero, man.
This is like one of those rare instances whenever you invent something and at the same time give nothing to the world as a result.
They invented...
Usually an invention is something that the world needs and it's answering, it's answering a need. And so
they invented a genre of music and contributed nothing to that invention.
Oh,
well, of course, it's not Elektra's fault. You could blame MTV for this one.
Well, listen,
MTV is the one that made this into something.
Why? Because they played the shit out of the video or whatever?
Yeah, Elektra was...
That was their label then?
Yeah, that was their label, and Elektra apparently fought them on a lot of shit, and I guess had problems with this song being on the album.
And really?
I
think a savvy, like, record guy.
Elektra was always fighting them.
What did they call those guys back?
The A&R guys.
Yeah. I think a savvy music industry record dude would be like, hey, man, that's a radio hit. And that's what this
No, and it was the opposite. Elektra didn't promote this song at all, which is why it wound up, MTV is the one that made this popular, because Elektra didn't promote it and they didn't play it on the radio because Elektra didn't promote it, and it was only popular because MTV played it.
All right, so culture vulturism, what do you give?
It's a zero, dude. They invented the power ballad.
Yeah, I don't see anything either, so I'm going to give it a zero as well. And let's just sidebar for a minute before we tally
Please,
this up.
Please, let's do that.
Okay, here's where I'm at with Motley Crue. When I was young and Motley Crue was big, I did not like them because I associated them with hair metal. And I had that testosterone thing that would not allow me to listen to bands that wore makeup. I just would not do it. So I would
And yet
listen.
You're a Kiss fan.
Well, that's
the different kind of makeup
different
though.
Kind of makeup. Yeah. But yeah, so the appearance, the hair thing, it just hold on, I gotta phlegm out. Hold on.
Nicely done.
The hair thing, I just couldn't handle. You know, it was just not my scene.
Neither.
So I did not listen to Motley Crue, and I nicknamed him Moldy Crotch, and I refused to listen to him. And so I was too busy. You know, I was into Slayer. You know what I mean? So I was not going to listen to Motley Crue. As the years went on, I was like, okay, I hear these songs on the radio all the time.
Did you acquiesce to a certain degree?
I like Dr. Feelgood. It's a killer track. It's got killer production. I like the lyrics. Sounds great. And so I was like, oh, cool. You know, I like that song. And I was like, but I didn't want to admit that I liked it. I was like,
what other songs are on that album, Dr. Feelgood?
Oh, Without You and other, it's basically the new Home Sweet Home.
Oh, yeah.
Kickstart My Heart.
Oh, Kickstart My Heart, right.
SOS. It was the Bob.
Girls, Girls, Girls?
No, I'll tell you. Well, here, I can break down a little bit of history. So basically, I'm like, at some point, I'm like, okay, I got to reckon with this Motley Crue thing. Because Motley Crue, in the eyes of metal fans, was always different than like Poison or Dangerous Toys or Britney Fox. Motley Crue was the sleazy one, right? So I was like, all right.
That's funny. Yeah, true.
Let me check out Motley Crue. So it took me a long time, but I was like, okay, I see what's going on here. So Motley Crue basically had like two, their first two records were highly regarded, Too Fast for Love and Shout at the Devil.
Yep.
And then by Theater of Pain, they completely changed up their image and went, they used to dress like the Road Warrior, you know, like bad guys in the Road Warrior.
Yep.
And then they switched to glam for Theater of Pain.
Yep.
And the record stunk. And by that point, the Nikki Sixx was full on heroin. Vince Neil had killed a guy in a car crash. Razzle, the drummer for Hanoi Rocks, he did time in prison, and so the band is like just hanging on. Drugs have taken over. They don't have any song. Nikki's the main songwriter. He doesn't have any songs. Vince Neil's clean because he's getting out of his prison time, and he's like, they're in a studio. They're completely fucked up, and Vince is sober now, and he's like, these songs stink, and he's like, I can't go on stage and sell this shit because I'm the singer. I got to sell it to the crowd, and these songs blow. And so they basically had two. So basically, this is where Motley enters into the realm of they're no longer capable of writing good albums. It's that every album will have.
Relatively speaking, because it is Motley Crue after all.
Right. But Shout at the Devil and Too Fast for Love are regarded as being good records. And that. After that, they entered into this window where they put out records that only had two good songs.
Right.
So from Theater of Pain, it was Smoking in the Boys Room and Home Sweet Home. And then the next record was Girls, Girls, Girls. And those tracks were Wild Side and Girls, Girls, Girls. Yeah. And the rest of the record was trash.
And, so and really, Wild Side's only gimmick was Tommy Lee's drum cage. Really, that was really.
Love the song Wild Side.
Yeah, it's okay.
I think the drum parts in it are rad, and I dig the song. I like the song. But this is where they basically they're only capable of mustering up two good songs per record, and the rest of the record's filler.
Theater of Pain Full. That's how bad that album is. Ooh, holy
it's
Christ.
A bad one. And then after that, they're like, okay, we can't write songs anymore. We need help. So they go to Bob Rock, who's like the super producer, and he gives them this big fat sound, helps them craft some songs, and they write this record that has a lot of radio hits on it, sounds great. Famously, Metallica heard it and was like, okay, this is what we got to sound like now, and they go and hire Bob to do the Black album. But so, and then Motley Crue breaks up after that.
So Motley Crue breaks Metallica.
Kind of, yeah.
Interesting.
So Motley was a band that, and I went back and I listened, and you know what? I actually like Too Fast for Love quite a bit. And when I hear it, I hear punk. I don't hear glam. It sounds
well, like, it's like, what, 81?
Yes.
82? So yeah, there's still definitely going to be some punk in there.
So it sounds super punky to me, which I kind of like. And then the same with Shout at the Devil. That record sounds, I hear a lot of punk in
it. Yeah, they're big live wires. They're totally punk in that song,
totally,
for sure.
Yeah, so you hear a lot of that like on those first two records, and that's what I like. And then when they go full on glam thing and Theater of Pain, I can't be. And then for me, it's real spotty. We're like, okay, I only like one song
and here, for a while until you get the feel good, and then it
yeah. But even
picks
that
up a
record,
bit.
I don't really like. I like the song Dr. Feelgood, and that's about it.
Yeah, you know? No, Dr. Feelgood's okay. Yeah, I don't mind that song.
Yeah.
Don't mind that at all.
So to me, they're a band that's capable of writing one or two good songs per album cycle. And that's it. You know, so there's just not really good songwriting going on.
Well, there. What we have here is how, all right, so like how important was it for them to write good music? They were just interested in entertaining, and they could entertain with shitty songs. They had they had really great stage shows, all the pyro and the makeup, and they really played to the crowd really well.
That's a great point. I mean, ultimately,
so they didn't have to write great music, they just had to perform it well.
Ultimately, it was like they were almost punk in that sense, where it was more about the image and the kind of like reputation of the band was more important than actually. And I think that's why they've spent so much of their time in recent years cultivating the dirt, the heroin diaries, all of this mystique around the bad boys stuff around the band, because they really don't have a musical legacy.
That's right.
They have a legacy of being degenerates and being sleazy rock and roll outlaws. And so they've put a lot of time into like crafting this. First, they wrote the Dirt book, which was like a big hit. Eventually, they did the Heroin Diaries book, which did really well. So they're crafting this outlaw image. And then they do the Saints of Los Angeles record, which continues to like hone this kind of LA outlaw image, and then they did the Dirt movie, which further
right.
It's just all about the image.
Think now. About that. Their version of being a nostalgia band is not playing great old music.
Oh, it has nothing.
Their version of nostalgia band is playing great memories of when they were hoodlums, right?
Right.
That's their version of being a nostalgia band. Like Kiss has this cool 70s catalog to go back to that so Motley Crue's version of that is their stories of yep. when they were not on stage.
And that's what they're selling to the fans.
That's
the
right.
fans are all middle-aged people now who are like, yeah, man, I want to remember the
they're
80s.
Selling the memories of the 80s.
Yeah, I want to remember the 80s when we did blow and fucked whatever moved and didn't
that's
care
right.
and being young. And that's what they're selling now. Mm-hmm. Is those that's their nostalgia.
That's their nostalgia.
Yeah.
The memories of the debauchery.
Yeah, and it always kills me whenever people are like, oh, will Motley Crue ever get into the Rock Hall? And I'm like, oh God, this is a band that like has, I mean, there's a lot of rock bands that are getting the shit.
They have maybe
the
a handful of good songs.
But this is a band that has no business
no,
sniffing the Rock
God,
Hall.
God, no.
The catalog is so thin. I mean, it is so
please, no.
thin. You know?
There's one, this episode, there's one major contribution that they made to the industry, and it was the power ballad.
Yeah, which actually ultimately tore down the very genre that they existed
precisely.
In, it became the only thing that, you know, record labels were chasing was that power ballad hit. But
you want to know what I thought was interesting, just to turn the page for just quickly a second about the movie? The Van Halen references in this movie. Do you remember that?
Yeah, what were they? I know David Lee Roth was in a scene, right?
The first reference was when, in the beginning, when they were looking for a singer, and they said they needed somebody like David Lee Roth.
Yeah, everybody wanted that.
All right.
Yeah.
So then the second reference was they were partying, and now they knew that they had made it because David Lee Roth was there partying with them.
Right.
And then the third reference was Vince Neil sitting on the couch watching a Van Hagar interview on TV as he was contemplating his career and being clean and all that jazz. And that's when his daughter came downstairs and woke up and he put her back to bed.
Right.
So I thought that was interesting for this reason, because as huge as Motley Crue was and they make this movie The Dirt, Van Halen is still unattainable, way above them.
That's interesting.
As huge as they were, Van Halen is like Motley Crue is like the Charles Barkley or the Shaquille O'Neal of the NBA, and then Van Halen is Michael Jordan, like right. above and beyond everybody else in the 80s is Van Halen, way up here. I thought that was really interesting that even as giant as Motley Crue was, Van Halen was still unattainable, way above them.
Yeah, and I think there's also a subtle thread there of by showing Vince Neil watching Van Hagar, he's seeing a band that they aspired to be replace their lead singer, which is what
successfully.
Motley Crue did. You know,
yeah.
Motley Crue replaced him with John Corabi, I think is how you pronounce his last
yeah.
name. And that 94 self-titled record that they did with him, it's very grunge influenced, but it's probably their best record, you know, in terms of just actual music. It's
yeah.
like, because he was actually a songwriter.
Yeah.
So now it's Six.
So they wrote a set of real songs.
So now Nikki Sixx wasn't solely responsible for writing all the music. He had somebody else who could help him.
And all that 80s shit was over with. So
yeah.
if you didn't have good music, then you were done. You were toast.
Yeah.
So they didn't have a choice but to write some good songs.
So that's probably a nod to, like, just to your point of the, you know, aspirational side of it. And then also Vince Neil just seeing an example of a band that was super successful, successfully changing their lead singer.
Yep.
You know, so. Yeah, it's a dude. I love that movie. I think it's a blast to watch.
I fought watching this movie for a long time because, like you, I was never a hair band fan in the 80s. Never, I just never was. Still am not. And I fought watching this movie. And you kind of talk as a guy I worked two different people at work have been telling me to watch this movie. And then you finally talked me into it since we were doing this episode. And I am really glad that I watched it. It was really entertaining. And I think MGK killed it as Tommy Lee.
Yeah, he was good in it. I think I
watched it.
And I'll go on record, too, as thinking that a lot of what I think they talk about in The Dirt and in the book and the movie is embellished. I don't know how much of it I even believe. You know, I think they're playing.
I mean, it is a movie.
Right. But I mean, I think in the book and the movie, they're playing up in the Heroin Diaries. I think they're playing up the mystique because, again, they don't have the goods. They don't have music.
Right.
So they have to play up the image and the, you know.
I mean, again, you know, it's their called tall tales. Tall tales do have an element of truth to them, but they're tall tales for a reason, right? And so we've got do we have a set of tall tales here? Are they making Paul Bunyan and Babe the Ox and shit like that? Perhaps.
I mean, we all know the tales. I mean, it's Nikki Sixx died. Vince Neil killed somebody. Tommy Lee and Pam and Tommy Lee and
Heather Locklear. They're getting headers in this club while they're doing coke on the table.
Yeah, it's and porn stars and all this. I mean, so there's all this mystique, right? All right, let's wrap this mug up. So, Rico, what is your score for this autopsy?
At a 0.5.
I've got a 0.5.
So, guess what? They contributed to rock and roll.
How are we going to spin this one?
I have no idea.
I think we have a song.
Because we did it. We did an episode a couple episodes ago remember we did Led Zeppelin a couple episodes ago?
Yeah.
And Led Zeppelin killed rock and roll. But yet Motley Crue, they contributed to rock and roll. It's a scientific method, man. You can't argue with science.
Here's the thing, is that this song is so wafer thin that it almost doesn't exist. So it's really hard to rate a song that has so little in it. There's just almost
nothing. It's like tissue paper.
It is. I mean, there's almost nothing to even talk about.
It's like balsa wood. There's no structural integrity to it at all. Listen, I mean, if you want to say it contributed to rock and roll, fine. It invented the power ballad. Motley Crue essentially invented hair metal, okay? So they have two major contributions to rock and roll, hair metal and the power ballad.
And then other bands just did those things better, I guess.
Precisely.
I mean, I'm not really a fan of either. I've tried to, as I've gotten older, I've tried to be more open-minded about hair because now I'm trying to look at rock and roll. Now that rock is dead and I can kind of look at it over the course of its history, I now see hair as just an evolutionary component.
You're seeing it like a History Channel episode.
I'm trying to.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying to look at the hair thing as just part of the natural evolution of the genre over a 50-year window of time when it was alive. And
you're appreciating the timeline.
I'm trying to.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at these bands now with a little more, with a lot less kind of disdain, and I'm trying to be more open-minded about their contributions. So
me too, but I still have trouble with it, man.
It's hard.
I mean, it took me all day to make it through Theater of Pain once.
Rat is another one that I've been trying because Warren DeMartini he's a great guitar player. God.
Well, they all had great guitar players. All were trying to follow Eddie Van Halen.
Right. But I will say this much is that I don't like these bands, but I'm trying to be open-minded. So I watched the Way Cool Junior video on YouTube.
Way Cool Junior!
Rico, the girls in this video. Holy hell. What a time. My goodness. Everybody,
the 80s, man.
Stop listening to this podcast right now and go watch.
Please cover your
red-blooded American males. Turn this off and go watch Way Cool Junior.
Go watch any rat video.
Holy hell. Anyway. Thank you, Motley Crue, for your contributions to rock and roll. This has been Rock and Roll Autopsy.
Good night now.
Let me have that special rock and roll music. Yeah.
Let me tell you, so the lyrics to real rock music is nothing more than satanic cyanide. Get it out of your house, throw it out, and burn it. It has no place in the house of the righteous.
You guys, it was like a mystique. There's no mystique anymore.
I'm gone.
Follow us on Twitter at RNR Autopsy, or you can send an email to rockandrollautopsy@gmail.com. And if we run across anything good, we'll mention it in a future episode. Thanks for listening. Later.
Well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.